Hello. By the way, that's a picture published by the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, and they have about 400,000 high-quality pictures in public domain from like the last 10 centuries. So you can go and download all of them. My name is Andreas Schaber. I live in Germany. I'm Board of Directors of Postgres Europe, so we are the organization organizing this Postgres Conference Europe that Daniel was talking about. Please come to Poland. I also work for Pivotal, so we had a small meeting here today, and that's why we are both here, joint hacky. You can find me on Twitter, and you can download this talk, or you can find the slides for this talk on my website. It's also linked on my Twitter profile. This talk is good for you if you, well, use Postgres or not use Postgres so far. If you're a regular reader of the Postgres Hackers mailing list, you probably know all of this, what I will talk about. Anyone here who is not familiar with Postgres? That's good. So, how many data types do we have in Postgres? Anyone got an idea? Please give me numbers. 20? 40? 40? 100? Anyone more? 8. Okay. Why 8? Okay, let's see. All data types are stored in a catalog table called PGType. Well, this one I looked up in my database, it says 361. Well, that's a lot. But it also includes a type for any table I have. So every time I create a table, I also get an entry in PGTypes which represents this table I have. Okay, let's exclude all my tables I have. It's still 82. That's a lot. Okay, that's a long list of types I have here. We have things like UID, we have numRange, any element, TS query, and so on. How many of you know all of these types? One hand goes up. It was hacky. Okay, but we have a very nice documentation in Postgres. So if you go to the Postgres documentation, you actually find a list of all of these types, including all the internal types like TS vector and TXID snapshot and so on. It explains all of this. I don't know how much time you have, but we want to talk about all of them. No. It's actually, you can talk like 2 days if you want to go into details. But next question, how many types are you using in your database, including varchar, text, and so on? Please give me numbers.
Not more than 15.
15, that's a lot. Anyone more than 10, except you. Anyone more than 5? Okay, a few hands. Anyone more than 20? Okay. We will talk about a few basic types here. I want to show you a few basic types, what you can do with Postgres. So talking about text types, numeric types, date types, and so on. And let's start with text types here. So we have 3 text types in Postgres, and internally they are all the same. Yes, you are right. So we have varchar and char. Both can have an optional length. And we have text. And all of them can store up to roughly 1 gigabyte. Internally, the representation is the same. And be careful, because all 3 of them are case sensitive. So if you want to compare 2 texts, and you actually want to compare them a case insensitive, you have to use I like, not like. And about the only difference you have here is, if you specify a length for varchar, it will store as many bytes as you specified, excluding white spaces. So if you specify a varchar 5, you can actually store 5 bytes plus 10 white spaces. Postgres doesn't care. Characters, sorry. If you do not specify a length for char, it's actually one character or one byte. So it's probably not what you want to use. So for char, you want to have a length. And this looks a bit complicated, but I want to show you what are the differences in white space handling between char and varchar. So I have 5 white spaces here, and I cast it to different types of varchar and char. As you can see, 5 white spaces casted to varchar 1 actually gives me a length of 1. Casted to 5 and to 10 still leaves it at 5. And now we look at char. I cast to char 1. Yes, I get my length of 1. And I cast it to 5. Yes, it's still 5. If I cast it to 10, it's length of 10. So for varchar, any space at the end is removed. And if I have a char 10, it's actually filled up with as many spaces or to as many spaces I have specified here. Yeah, it's a fixed length. And it's filled up with white spaces. But only in char, not in varchar. Yeah, that's why I had to use octet length to count what's actually returned. If you just use length, length will cut off the white space at the end. Took me a while to figure this one out. Oh yeah, length and char length will return 0 because it will cut off the white spaces. I think it's white spaces and tabs. Yeah. Anyway, the takeaway here is varchar will remove all white spaces at the end, and char will actually fill up to the length you specify. So, how does Postgres store a text up to 1 gigabyte internally? So we have pages in Postgres, and each of them is 8 kilobyte by default. You can change it at compile time, so you actually have to recompile if you want to have bigger pages. And any row or any column is placed into this page here. You have a page header, and then you have your rows and so on. And one row has to fit into a page. So you cannot have a row which is bigger than 8 kilobyte. How do you store 1 gigabyte in 8 kilobyte? Well, you can try compression up to a certain length. What Postgres does, anytime you have a variable length like text, like numeric and so on, it starts outsourcing the data into an extra table, which is called toast table. And here in my original table, I only have a pointer, 4 bytes, pointing into my toast table. And here I can consume as many rows as I have up to 1 gigabyte. Postgres is doing all of this for you internally, so you don't have to take care about this. You don't even see it. If you select from this table, it will actually pull in the data from a toast table and build a representation for you. The only time you really see this toast table is here if you run a vacuum on your database. You run a vacuum verbose, it will tell you it does not only vacuum this table, but it will also vacuum this table here. That's about the only time you see this. What about this char 255? Anyone here using char or varchar 255? Anyone seen this before? Quite a few hands. Anyone using this? I only run into this when I do migrations from MySQL databases, actually. You can see both results show about 500,000 both queries show about 500,000 results on Google and about 11,000 projects on search code. All of them actually MySQL projects. No idea why. There's no actual limit in Postgres why you should use varchar 255. There's no reason. But in MySQL, if you use InnoDB, it can index a key up to 3 times 255. So if your key is longer than 255 bytes, it cannot use this key for an index or not a full length. That might be a reason why many people in MySQL actually limit their key column to 255 bytes. And that's where I see it most, because when we migrate from MySQL to Postgres, that's something we change. We actually try to figure out, okay, what do we have in this column here? Because 255 is an arbitrary length, and we don't need to keep this length around. Numeric times. So we have three different numeric types for any use case. First of all, we have integers, starting with 2 bytes, basically ranging from minus 32k to plus 32k. We have 4 bytes, minus 2 billion to plus 2 billion. So it's always a signed integer here. And we have a big int with 8 bytes from 2, 9. I have no idea what it is. It's a large number. And one thing to mention here, be careful how you align your columns. So most people like to align their columns in a table by names and then how they use a table and then just do a select star. Basically for Postgres, you don't have to care how you align your column names, but if you do something like a small int and an integer and then small int and integer again, it will actually use 4 bytes for the small end and just leave 2 bytes empty. It will always align by the 4 bytes here. So if you rearrange your columns and have a small end and a small end, it will use 4 bytes for the 2 small ends and in total only use 12 bytes here and 16 bytes here. So 4 bytes for like 10,000 rows, it's not much. 4 bytes for 100 million rows. Well, it's some disk space you can save. We also have floating point types with 4 bytes and with 8 bytes. And a floating point is always a base and an exponent. So even though it might show you the exact value you entered, internally it's always rounded. It's never storing the exact amount you stored in a database. Give you some examples here. That's 6 digits, so 100,001. And it shows you in the output, yeah, it's 100,001. If I expand this one to 1,000,001, you see it starts emitting the base and exponent here. Same with a real, which here I have 6 digits only, but it starts rounding up my number. So even though I entered an exact number here, because I cast it as a real, it gets rounded up. So never ever store any money or any number which must be precise in a floating point type. The same is true for floating point, which is using 8 bytes. So I have 15 digits here. It looks like it's exact. I expand it to 16 digits and it starts rounding. Even, or here I have 15 digits plus 1 decimal digit, it starts rounding my number. As I said, never ever store something like money or such in a floating point number. We have other data types for this. We also have a money type in Postgres. I know about 2 people actually using it. Like 3 times it was declared dead and resurrected and someone wrote code for it. Don't use it. Please don't. The other problem with money, it always comes with a currency. Whatever you have defined in LC monetary in your operating system, this is used in your money type. So it can only be like euro or dollar or whatsoever, but there's no conversation between euro and dollar. Doesn't really make sense. But it can actually hold the entire US debt. Okay, if you have to store something like money, please use numeric. And numeric is precise to up to 1,000 digits. So the way you define it is numeric in this example here, it's 10 and 3, and you define the total number of digits you have, and then the number after the decimal point. So it's 7 digits before and 3 after, it's 10, 10, 3. Numeric is handled in software. Unlike an integer, which you can just load into a CPU register and do calculation in one tact in a CPU, this has to be handled in software, so it's a bit slower. It's not as fast as an integer. So, anyone know this guy? Never heard of? Anyone been to India? You never met him? And now? Okay, about how many waste coins are we talking about? So we start with one, and we double the number of waste coins on each field on a chessboard. How much is it? If you just use double precision here, you see it's not very exact. If you use numeric, 2 to the power of 64, using numeric, 2 to the power of 64 minus 1, we get a very exact number. And we only use like 20 digits here, so we have 980 left. If you ever found a use case for numeric which exceeds numeric, please let me know. We also have sequences. In other databases, they are also known as auto-increment columns. In Postgres, it's a regular data type, and a sequence is attached. So if you specify a serial in Postgres as data type, what actually happens is Postgres will use an integer data type, create a sequence, and attach this sequence to the table, and make it the default value for this column. Sounds complicated? Well, Postgres does it for you. A sequence by default starts with 1 and steps 1 forward and does not cycle around. Might be a problem if you use a small serial, which is plus 32k, and once you reach the 32k, it will not cycle around and start again. It will just raise an error. A sequence is owned by a table. That means if you drop this table, Postgres will also drop the sequence for you. Takes care of the maintenance. But you can use the same sequence in multiple tables as default value, basically making it a global auto-increment column. And the sequence is not transactional. Anytime you fetch a value from a sequence, it's gone. It's not given back if you roll back a transaction. So you can have gaps in your sequence numbers. Like, you start a transaction, you insert 50,000 values, it will fetch 50,000 values from a sequence, then you roll back, the next insert will get 50,001. You can ask Postgres for the current value of a sequence by specifying select current value and sequence name. But it will only work if you use the sequence in a current session before. Like you do an insert, then you can ask the database, okay, what was the value you inserted into my column? And this is local per session. So if you have 3 different sessions doing 3 different inserts, you still get the value back you inserted and not the other users. You can also ask for the next value, so basically counting 1 forward by default. And yes, you can reset a sequence. Basically saying, yeah, I inserted this 50,000 values, I rolled it back. Now let's set back my sequence as well. You can do this. Select set wall and select the max ID from a table. Will just give you the next value next time you insert something. Be careful if you reset a sequence or set a sequence to a value which is already in the table, you will get a primary key collision. Because at some point it will fetch a value from a sequence which is in a table, and if it's a primary key, this will be a unique constraint violation. Postgres can also give you the sequence name which is attached to a specific column. Like here I have my sequence table, my ID, my column is ID. And I can ask Postgres pgget serial sequence, table name, column name, and it will return me the name of the sequence used as a default value. Which is quite handy because by default it's always table name, column name, underscore sequence, but someone might have changed the name or manually created a sequence. So please use this function and don't rely on a default name. And a sequence in the end acts just like a table. So you can select from a sequence as well. Select start from my sequence name here, gives me the name. It says where the sequence started, what my increment is, what my maximum value is, and so on. All the details I want to know. Good. Anyone can tell me what this is? Okay, South Pole. Any other options? How do you know? It looks like. Well, it tells you actually. It says 90 degrees south. Okay, what's the time at South Pole right now? How many of you have a Postgres database here? It will tell you. We have a number of date and time data types. So we have timestamp with and without time zone. There are basically two different opinions if you should use with or without time zone. Some people really prefer to store everything in UTC, and some people just use with time zone and always specify a time zone. Do whatever you like. We also have a time with and without time zone. And we have a date, obviously without time zone because it's just a date. And we have an interval, which is the difference between two times. Postgres will deal with daylight saving time for you. So if you specify a time zone, it will know about it's summertime, it's winter time. If you do calculations between time zones and timestamps, it will get this right. However, it does not know about leap seconds because a leap second is nowhere stored. So the time zone database only knows about when was the time zone changed, which date in which country, and so on. Not a leap seconds. Okay, some examples. Here, I have what it looks like a date. I cast it to a timestamp. So because I did not specify a time, I just get back midnight. Here I use the text format for a date, and you see, even though I specified a name, Postgres recognizes the text and gives back a January as an ISO date. Yeah, but I can't remember. I've seen some cases where time is used. Well, easy way, just submit a PR to remove it and see how many people start crying. here I specify a time zone. It's 3:25 p.m., so I can actually use 12 hours UTC as a timestamp. And I get back 1725. So what's the difference here? Why does it say 525? Because the output of a time zone or a timestamp It's always in your server time. And this server is configured in European Standard Time. I live in Berlin. So even though I specified a timestamp in UTC, it's converted to summer time in Berlin because it's August. So that's one of the reasons why some people prefer to always use UTC for all of their time zones and dates and times and so on to avoid this problem. Another example, in December, it's 10:23, and you see it's only 1 hour difference between because it's winter time. This also means I have to change my time zone if I want to know a time in a different time zone. What I can do here, I can specify a different time zone. In this case, it's Europe Moscow. And again, Postgres knows how to handle different time zones. And the Russians, a few years ago, they changed to summertime and never changed back. They stay at summertime. So Postgres knows when this change happened, and if you specify a year before that, it knows how to handle summer and winter time for Russia. If you specify a date after this date where they did the change, it will just use summertime. It's all stored in a time zone database in your operating system. However, if you only specify a time zone number like +4 here, obviously there can't be any daylight saving time because it's just a number. It's not a time zone name. So if I want to have my time for a different time zone, I have to specify a different time zone. One way I can do this is I set a time zone name in my session. And here I start a transaction because inside of a transaction, my time stops. You start a transaction, you do select now a few times, and you will see it will always return the same time, the time your transaction started. So I do select now here, it's 13:55. I change my time zone to Moscow, it's 15:55, for a 2 hours difference between Berlin and Moscow. So this looks quite complicated, right? There's a better way to do. Every time I use a timestamp, I can also specify a time zone for this timestamp. Select now a time zone Europe Moscow. Just for this one value here, it will be converted to Europe Moscow time zone. You see, 15:55. As I mentioned, you can do calculations between two timestamps. Here, 2005th of January minus 2001st of January gives me 4 days interval. Turning it around, 1st of January minus 4th of January gives me minus 3 days. I can also use times, not only dates, which tells me, okay, it's 10 days, 17 hours, and so on, difference between these two times. One way where I can use this, 28th of February plus 1 day. In a leap year, it will give me 29th. If it's not a leap year, it will give me a 1st of March. So, was 2000 a leap year or not? If you trust Postgres, it was. So, every 4th year is a leap year, except if it's divided by 100, then it's not a leap year. But if it's divided by 400, it is. And 2000 obviously can be divided by 400. Okay, another way. 1st of January 2001 minus 1st of January 2000 gives me 366 days. It's a leap year. And 2002 minus 2001 gives me 365 days. It's not a leap year. Coming back to my South Pole question. There's a station next to South Pole. It's called Scott Amundsen Station. It belongs to the United States, but it's supplied from New Zealand. And for logistic reasons, they use New Zealand time zone. Makes things easier. So now we know how to calculate time at New Zealand. It's too easy, isn't it, right? Actually, your computer knows what the time at South Pole is. Because every station we have on the South continent got its own time zone. United States have Scott Amundsen Station. It's the same time as New Zealand. The Germans have a station down there. The Russians have one. I don't know about Finland. UK has one as well. It's aligned to London. So we have like 11 different time zones on South continent, Antarctica. Quite funny. Anyone still using XML? That's good. People are moving on. It was hot in the 90s, 2000s, but I think I can skip it if you don't use it. Anyone using JSON? Let me reverse the question. Anyone not using JSON? JavaScript object notation, those are things Sun developed back in the 90s with JSON, actually made its way into the database. It's basically a framework how to transport data between different devices and applications in a more or less human readable format. Postgres by now has two different JSON data types. The old one is JSON, which stores the data as it comes in. There's no parsing at storing time, but the data must be parsed every time you want to read it. And there's JSONB or JSON binary. It will parse the data when it stores, and it has nice features like you can create an index on top of a JSON column or whatever column is in a JSON data type. And it's all inside of your regular transactions you know from Postgres. And it's so fast that we actually have customers moving away from MongoDB to Postgres, because JSONB in Postgres is faster than JSON in MongoDB. What reason do you have to stay on Mongo? It's a very simple JSON type, so I have to use double quotes for the text in JSON, and then using single quotes for Postgres, cast it to a JSON, and you see I end up with my JSON string here. I can also create arrays in JSON, so I get my array definition here back, or key value pairs. I can store all of them in my column if it's a JSON column. I can also query in my key value pairs. Like if I only want to have key 2, I use this right arrow here and just ask for this 2 value here. It's DEF. I can also find out if a specific element I'm searching for is in my array list or key value list. So other databases which just store your JSON actually have to pull out this entire data set and then in your application try to figure out if this element is in your list. Here Postgres can do it for you. You don't have to pull out all the data and do it in your application. Do I have this element in this list? Same again for key value pairs here. And as I mentioned before, I can have an index on top of a JSON column. Looks like this. Create an index on my table using JIN index framework. Or I want to have an index on my data column, and in JSON it's a name column. Then only this name field in my data column in Postgres is indexed. And if I query this field, then index will be used. It's fast. Anyone using Boolean types? Anyone not using Boolean types? Anyone using integer types as Boolean? I've seen this before. Like MySQL has a Boolean type, but under the hood it's an integer type. And you end up 0, 1, yes, but what is 7 in a Boolean type? And of course, the developer writing the 7 into the column is long gone. So if you want to migrate from MySQL to Postgres, you actually have to figure out, yeah, what is this 7 thing doing in my Boolean column? Now in Postgres, we have a real Boolean column, which returns true and false, but accepts a number of additional values. Like you can say 2 or 1 or T or Y or yes. And of course, 0 and F and no for the false value. This works.
And off also, very practical for internet to think on and off.
Yeah, on and off. So here I have my true value adjusted to Boolean. You see, I get my T back and I get my false back. Heike, do you know why we use T and F and not? You can have 0 and 1. I know that at least one PHP driver. I know that at least one PHP driver of a PHP 5 had trouble with the T and F. It always casted it to true. Yeah, because literally in a code they were looking if it's 0 or not. It's not 0. It's TNF. Must be true. So one example here. I have a Boolean column, I have a log table here, so some ID here, some content here. And I can use a conditional index to find out any log row which actually contains an error. So my table here, I write in a million rows, and for 2% of the rows, I want to have this error flag set to true. For 98%, I want to have set it to false. Because if you have a log table, most of your log entries are probably not errors, but you are mostly interested in the ones which raised an error. Come again?
You could just do, instead of the case when random construct, just have random.
No, then I get between 0 and 1 values.
No, you have just random less than.
Yeah. I actually prefer to write out what I do to make it more descriptive. Okay. For my table, if I just want to find out all rows where error is true, you see I get a sequential scan. It's quite expensive for my 1 million rows. But I'm only interested in like 2% of those rows. I don't care about the 98%. Of course, I need to store them, but I are not interested in them. Now I create an index on my column, a conditional index, which will only store the rows where error is set to true. Because again, 98%, I don't care. And now if I use the same query again, my query came down to a cost of 68. Because this index only contains what I'm looking for. And to give you some comparison about the cost and the disk space here, I have another index which indexes 100% of the rows. And you see the full index has 2,745 pages. My partial index only has 57 pages. And out of the 2,745, I'm not interested in 2,690 pages. So I don't need to store them in my index. That's one nice use case for Boolean here. Okay, anyone using bit types? Oh. Let's skip this. anyone storing binary data? Why? Please? And you? Why are you storing binary data in a database? Transactions. Okay. Okay, what's the problem with storing binary data in Postgres? Escaping is a problem. And the problem is Postgres is written in C. C has no real string handling, but a string in C ends when there's a binary zero byte, where no bit is set. If you try to store some data using a regular query string, send it to the database, your query will end where there's a byte with no bit set. So you very likely get a parse error for your query. The way to avoid this problem is by having a binary data type, and this data type is a length, and this length specifies how many bytes to read. So you don't have to parse the string, you just read as many bytes as specified. So there's no reading and no searching for end of string. Again, this can store up to a gigabyte of data, or roughly a gigabyte of data. Any programming language with a Postgres driver out there has functions how to handle binary data and byte A data type. Please use them. Please don't implement your own functions for storing and retrieving binary data from Postgres. We have two different ways how we can output binary data in Postgres. We have a parameter which is called byte A output. By default, newer Postgres versions have set this one to hex, and the old version was byte A, was escape. In escape format, you have a backslash here, and then you specify 1, 2, or 3 digits, and this is an octet code for the ASCII character you want to display or you want to transmit. One of the problems is you have to escape the escape character. And Postgres actually has to parse the string looking for backslashes and then find out how many characters after the backslash belong to the next character it has to show. And here in the new hex format, we always have 2 characters here, so we don't have to do any length parsing, which is quite CPU intensive. So this one takes a bit more space, roughly, but it's faster to read and write. Anyone storing network data like IP addresses, MAC addresses, network masks, what are you using to store this?
Generic IP address field in Java.
You? Yeah. What was the third one?
I'm using the same escape.
Okay. So you probably work together. We have 3 data types in Postgres to store IP addresses and network addresses. It's INET, which stores an IP address, can be IPv4 or IPv6, both, and a network mask. We have CDDR, which only stores a network address. And we have MAC address, which is a 6-byte for MAC Ethernet address. And the nice thing is, you can actually use an index to find values in these columns. So here I have a regular IP address / network mask for 256 IP addresses. I cast it to an INET and you see it returns me my IP address and my network mask. If I only specify an IP address, it will actually cast it to 32 for an IPv4 address, which is only a single address. And if I leave out some parts of my IP address, it will make a guess what kind of network I am using here. So in this case, I left out a 4th octet here, and it did cast it to .0/24 for 256 IP addresses. I have an example table here using an inet data type and create an index on it. And I insert three different values from 1918 ranges, 192.168, two of them, and from a 10 range, a third one. And now I want to know which IP addresses in my table are in this range. And the index will actually answer this question and return the two IP addresses which belong into this range I specified. You see, I get an index scan here on my column, which makes it very fast. I don't have to scan my entire table. Good. Last but not least, you can create your own data types in Postgres. Anyone done this before? What did you create? You? You probably created a new base type. I actually created a new Boolean type to get around this nasty problem in PHP 5, which returns 0 and 1 to make it work. So we have a number of different ways to do this. So we have composite types, we have enumerations, and of course you can go and write your entire own data type with input-output functions and so on. Let's look at enumerations for fun. So we have a list of predefined values. You can make an enumeration out of this one. Your best chance is if this list is never going to change. So if you have a list which might change in the future, please use a lookup table. Don't create an enum type. I want to give you an example. Many people use an enum for gender. How many different gender types do you know?
Three.
Anyone else? Well, I think Facebook defines 58. Expanding over time. Well, there's actually an ISO standard for this. So we have male, we have female, of course, we have unknown, so we really don't know. But we can also have denied, so someone knows but prefers not to specify. From a medical perspective, that's different. We have today male, today female, and so on. If we look into the nature, we also have hybrid or actually have not applicable. And a number more. As I said, there's a whole standard looking into this. Anyone knows this game? I know it's a German game. In Germany it's called Skat, I don't know if what's called here. So we have four colors here, or four. This never change. It's a perfect example for an enum. I can actually find my own type, diamonds, hearts, spades, and clubs. And then I can use this data type I defined here, like any other data type in my table. If I want to insert something, I can use my name. And of course, if I want to select something or compare something, I can again use my name I defined. And if I try to insert something which is not defined here, Postgres will just deny it. I get an error back. Perfect example for an enum. Okay, we are done. There are many more data types. Remember, we had like 50-something data types. I'm not talking about here this entire range of Postgres data types. It's not covered. Range data types, composite types, OID, UUID, and so on. That's material for another talk, advanced data types talk. But that's it. Thank you.